Hello everybody, I'm Nick, and in this video I'm going to introduce you to a brand new feature coming in C# 12 called Alias Any Type or Using Directives for Additional Types. Now this feature builds on something that we already had before, but the way it builds on it completely expands and changes how you can use it. Previously, it was very used in a very limited use case, and I'm going to show you what that was in this video, but now you can actually use it to do some very cool and nasty stuff if you're not careful. So we're gonna see all that in this video. If you like the type of content and you wanna see more, make sure you subscribe, ring the notification bell, and for more training, check out dometrain.com. That is right, nickchapsas.com is no more. If you go and try to access that website to find my courses, you will be redirected to a brand new website called dometrain.com. Dometrain is a new brand for me where I'm going to be hosting all of my existing courses and any future ones. Not only that, but there's some really, really cool stuff coming and I can't wait to announce it, but that's for another time. For now, to celebrate the launch, I'm offering the first 100 of you a 15% discount on any of my courses. So go to dometrain.com, check out the courses, whether that is testing, dependency injection, REST APIs, minimal APIs, just find what you want and use code LAUNCH at checkout to get a 15% discount on anything. Now back to the video. Okay, so let me show you what I have here. I have a simple console application, doesn't really have anything. We have this example class, which I will be using to showcase the feature. And to start, I wanna show you what we had before C# 12. So at this point, this is not using the preview version of C#. So what we already had is the following. We could say, for example, that I don't wanna be typing var sb equals new string builder, for example, over here to create a new string builder. So what I could do is I could say using sb equals string builder. So now the string builder class has an alias called sb, meaning I can actually use it interchangeably for this type. Now, this is a bad example. Don't do this. You should not abbreviate the types of the classes, but I'm just showing you the very basic idea of this feature. You can have an alias on a type. Now, what's also very interesting is that you can have something like list of ints here. And if you have a list of a generic and the generic is an integer, you can have this list here. And this can be a list of ints, and it will act as a list. You can add range. Everything you had in that list will be applicable here. It is just an alias. Now, the problem with this is that it was very, very limited. In fact, the most common use case for something like this would be that if you have two things named the exact same thing and they live in a different namespace, you can actually give them an alias and say point 2D in this area and point 2D in this area, and then use them without having to have fancy, fully qualified namespaces and so on in your code base. But you could not do something like this, for example, where you have like an array of integers. So if I go here and I cut this and I try to do this, this was not possible. And if you want to have a nullable integer, you could not do any of that. In fact, I'm pretty sure you couldn't even do the non-nullable integer. Yeah, this does not work. So clearly a very limiting feature. You couldn't really do much with it, but it was nice to have, especially for those ambiguity checks when it comes to namespaces. However, if I go ahead and I enable C# 12 over here by saying lang version preview, which enables this preview feature, I can go back to my class and I can do some really, really cool stuff. For example, now I can go here and say using db int equals int nullable, and I can use that as an integer. So if I say var number equals new db int, then that will create a default database integer, for example, here. So I can say something like this. I can say number and then just print it. So given that this is actually nullable, if I go ahead and I run this, I'm going to get nothing in the console when this eventually runs. So that's why you don't see anything here. But if I go here and I say, for example, db int 1, and you can see how this comes together here, then it's going to return 1 here, as you can see, and so on and so forth. So it's a very interesting and, quite frankly, weird way of working with numbers. You wouldn't really do that for an integer, but now you can. But here's where this gets interesting. First, the array thing actually does work now, but also you can have tuples here, which means that I can do this. I can say using point 2D equals int int, a point in 2D space x and y. So if I say var point equals this and I give this type the point 2D, then I can treat this as an initializer and say, I don't know, some values. So if I print this, given that this is a tuple behind the scenes, I should be able to actually see the values. And I do print it as a tuple. So they carry that value in them. Now, why is that interesting? Well, it's interesting because first, you can have item one and item two, and you can carry state in that way. Initialization looks not quite like a constructor, I guess, with the new thing that you can do here, which, by the way, also works, which is weird. I guess it's fine, but you can also say new point to D. And if I block this, this does look like a class or a struct with an initializer, which is where this gets weird, because you can also technically have a point to D struct or a point 3D, for example. So I can say record struct point 3D, and this will be int X, int Y, int Z. And if I hide all this and I go all the way down here, then you have the point in 3D space, which is the point 3D, and I can have other parameters here. So this one, and this one, and you don't know what's what. Now, the interesting thing is that you can't actually use the same syntax for the record struct, but you can use it for this one, which I'm not gonna lie, I quite like. Coming from Kotlin, which is a language where the new keyword doesn't really exist, I like how easy it is to create this, but it does feel out of place. Of course, both of these indexes would work here with the new keyword, and the full name would also work. But you might be thinking, oh, that's fine, but Nick, who wants to use something that calls the parameters item one and item two, because it is a tuple? But because it is a tuple, you can also do this. You can go up here and say X and Y. And this is valid C sharp now. So if you want to use a single parameter of that tuple, which uses an alias to represent itself, then you have X and Y here, which is just, it's interesting. And I'm sure that there's use cases where this will make sense, but I feel like it can also be abused quite a bit. Like, it is nice that we can do that, but should we be able to do that? I don't know. I find this dynamic very interesting. And the other thing that you could do technically is you can have a struct called point2d, and you can have a type alias on a tuple with the same structure called point2d. Now, this will cause ambiguity, and it's going to say that, hey, there's a conflict between the alias and the type, which makes it even more confusing. But what makes it even more confusing is that because in C# 10 we got global using statements, I could technically just take this from here, go to global usings, create this here, say global, and now anything can use this and it won't know that this is a tuple. I guess if you start stepping into things, you will find out, but it's very interesting that this is allowed. And if I just quickly comment this out and comment this out, now this is using something that technically looks like a public class or a public struct, which can be used anywhere. So as long as it's here, it's sort of a private thing, but when it is in global using, it is used everywhere. It's a very interesting dynamic, and I'm very interested to see what some creative people do with this. I really hope that people don't start using this in clever ways, which will lead to magic, which can lead to other problems, because even though I think there's value here, it has to be very clear what this thing is. I think overall this feature is a net positive because it does enable you to do some really cool stuff, especially if no one else gets to use your code base. But you have to be very careful to not confuse people, because things like this will cause confusion, I can guarantee it. But now I want to know from you, what do you think about this feature? Is it something you will use? And what other crazy ideas do you have about using this in your own code base? Leave a comment down below and let me know. Well, that's all I had for you for this video. Thank you very much for watching. Special thanks to my Patreons for making videos possible. If you want to support me, you're gonna find the link in the description down below. Leave a like if you like this video, subscribe, won't click on like this and ring the bell as well. And I'll see you in the next video. Keep coding.